Welcome back. I'm that chemist, and today we have a story where somebody burned down their lab because they went to get Arby's. I once filled a balloon with an air duster and took a lighter to it to make a fireball. I was smart enough to do it outside, but it didn't change much. A couple moments of amusement quickly turned into a painful coughing fit. There was no wind, and I guess the hot gases didn't disperse and just rose right into my face. Being outdoors isn't always enough ventilation. The issue here is one of the propellants that's used for consumer products is often difluoroethane. And when you burn difluoroethane, that fluoro has to go somewhere, and that fluoro can quite often become hydrogen fluoride. And hydrogen fluoride is a gas that you do not want to be breathing in. So while he did this outside, you have to make sure that the wind's blowing the right way so that that HF isn't going towards you. And nonetheless, I would not encourage you to burn difluoroethane at all. When I was about 9 years old, we went to a geology museum in London. We were shown lots of special rocks, including a blue rock which came off in fibers. Yep, they gave me blue asbestos to play with. Do I win 5 euros? I'm sorry, I'm fresh out of euros, but if you come to Canada, I'm happy to give you some of our blue Monopoly money. I don't know if it's worth anything, but every time I pass go, I get another 200, and all the stores have accepted it so far, so I guess that's good. In our fourth semester in organic lab, we were supposed to make a ferrofluid using tetramethylammonium hydroxide solution as a stabilizer near the end of the prep. We were told that approximately 3 milliliters of the stuff could be deadly upon skin contact, and the prep used about 2 milliliters. This didn't happen in my lab, but a friend of mine managed to poke herself with a syringe that she had used for the tetramethylammonium hydroxide. The reaction of the supervisors present? She was sent home with a lab partner who was told to watch her, and a week later got an email asking if she was doing okay. Yeah, I would send that person to the hospital and call poison control because you're not necessarily aware of all the associated risks. Recently, someone in the Discord brought up that tetramethylammonium salts are actually quite toxic. The toxicity of tetramethylammonium salts comes from the similarity to acetylcholine. Acetylcholine is a neurotransmitter that's important in the body, and a lot of chemists work with tetramethylammonium salts, and I had never even heard of their toxicity until recently. I have literally made tens of grams of perfluoroalkoxide-based tetramethylammonium salts, and I didn't realize that I needed to be worried about both the potential HF that could be formed from the salt reacting with water, as well as the fluorophosgene that's formed from the anion trifluoromethoxide decomposing, but also I needed to worry about the tetramethylammonium salt. So I think tetramethylammonium trifluoromethoxide is a good candidate for one of the most toxic compounds I've ever worked with, although I didn't realize that the tetramethylammonium salt was as bad as it is. If you've ever worked with tetramethylammonium salts and have any associated stories, I would love to hear those. So I've got some short stories to share from my time in undergrad labs. In the third semester of my bachelor's, the basic inorganic chemistry lab took place. We were randomly sorted into pairs to share a fume hood. The first experiment involved the synthesis of tin tetraiodide or antimony triiodide, one each per fume hood. We were given straight instructions to brainlessly follow, prepare the glassware following Schlenk technique, weigh the metal and add it, add solvent, and lastly weigh the iodine and directly add it shortly afterwards. Everybody begins to follow the procedure step by step as they were told, but my dear fume hood partner at one point just stood around doing nothing. So I asked, "Do you know what to do?" "I don't." "Did you prepare the metal?" "Yes, everything's prepared." Turns around and points to the bench behind us. As I was about to give her a hint to continue, the PhD student in charge re-entered the lab and immediately started screaming angrily, "Whose iodine is this?" My partner innocently claimed it. Turns out that she had weighed several grams of elemental iodine some 30 minutes ago, and thick purple vapors were crawling on the lab floor already. Fortunately, nobody inhaled any of it. Yeah, that's definitely lucky. I've got slight whiffs of iodine here and there, and it can be overpowering pretty quickly. Most of the time, if you're working with stuff that produces noxious gases, it's good to do that in the fume hood, although that can sometimes be challenging because scales can fluctuate. So I think this is more of an issue of the people in charge not training her appropriately, or perhaps it's one where she hadn't read the procedure appropriately. Always look at the safety data sheets for chemicals before you work with them, especially the first time you work with them. A friend of mine was looking for a mercury diffusion pump, which had been stored away on the third floor of a new building, behind a wall covering. He found the stored pump, took it out of its storage space, and it fell over. Problem? It was still full of several kilograms of mercury, which spilled onto the floor. The third floor? Yep, it headed straight for the elevator shaft and down to the basement. My friend, head of chemistry at the local university, loves it when I ask him to recount the story. I mean, it's definitely a story worth sharing. I don't remember if this happened at the university that I attended or if this was at a different university and I just heard about the story secondhand, but there was this story of a janitor who stole a bunch of mercury from a university. Mercury is not that valuable, but it was valuable enough that this person was interested in stealing it. So for quite a while, they had been stealing this mercury in their mop bin. So they would just pour the mercury into their soapy water with the mop, and that worked every single time, no big issues. But one time they had a metal bucket for their mop water, and you can guess what happens when mercury comes in contact with metal. You might be skeptical that it would get all the way through it, but once it started penetrating the bucket, the whole thing shattered and it leaked mercury and the soapy water everywhere, and that was when the guy got caught. He was no longer a janitor at that university. Generally on topic, I am not a chemist, but I did commit one of the worst things the average Joe could ever do to themselves at home. Mustard gassed myself. So I'm cleaning the bathtub when I had the bright idea to grab two separate cleaners, I think it was bleach and toilet cleaner, and pour them into the tube. As a clean freak, it made sense at the time. I don't recall if any vapors were visible, but the instant I coughed, then coughed up some blood, I realized I screwed up. I opened the window to let the fumes out, and washed away the toxic mess that was still in the tub. Eventually got to the hospital later that day, in case I did something horrible to myself, and was no worse for wear a week or so later. Toilet bowl cleaner is often ammonium hydroxide. Ammonium hydroxide is just ammonia in water. If you mix ammonia and bleach, you don't get mustard gas, but you do get another really toxic compound called trichloroamine. This also produces another compound called chloroamine, both of which are really toxic, and they're that stereotypical swimming pool smell, because there's amounts of ammonia and urea in water that will react with the bleach in the pool water. Now, the amounts that you get in pool water are usually safe, but they can contribute to the red eyes that you get from swimming in a swimming pool, as long as you haven't been doing anything else that might make your eyes red. But in the amounts that you get when you immediately mix concentrated bleach and ammonia, it's really unsafe. So I constantly see memes on the internet about accidentally making mustard gas at home. It isn't actually mustard in the traditional sense. A mustard usually requires a chloroethyl group, like in sulfur mustard or nitrogen mustard. Although this is still a really terrible compound that you do not want to make, and people have certainly suffered as a consequence of mixing these chemicals before. Don't mix cleaning products unless you know it's absolutely safe to do so. I have breathed hydrogen selenide. It was the worst experience in my life. It feels like you lose feeling and functionality progressively from your throat down your airways, millimeter by millimeter. You just stand there and think, it will reach my lungs and I'm going to die. And I don't think that there were more than 2 ppm in the air at the worst moment. I read that it smells horrible, but I honestly couldn't smell it at all, or was too scared to notice. So in my case, when I smelled hydrogen selenide, I'd made this reagent called Wollin's reagent. Wollin's reagent is kind of like the sulfur compound Lawson's reagent, but it's slightly different and it has selenium instead of sulfur. And it does have a slight smell to it, but the attacking feeling in your throat is way faster, and this description is on point. You feel it get worse and worse, lower and lower, and that's when you freak out. It hits, and it doesn't go away. When it happened to me, I had a sore throat for like several days afterward, and I had some like minor flu-like symptoms. But I definitely smelled it, and it was not good at all. It was a very pungent, unpleasant smell. So I went to an old rural high school with a lot of interesting history and lore, like how the internet for the school was wired by the psychology teacher through the old internal phone board. Anyway, this is a story of a series of events told to me by my chem teacher. The first step in this comedy of errors is the school decides to save money by buying several lab chemicals in bulk, most of which will have their labels degrade over the years. The one chemical we are interested in is a huge jug of 10% silver nitrate. Back then, apparently they didn't know that 10% silver nitrate was toxic. So the chemistry teacher would just give students a thimble full to do an experiment where they extracted the silver. The chemistry teacher would save up the silver from each year's batch of students so that he could melt down the silver into a bar when he was close to retiring. On the appointed day, the chem teacher gets a crucible and proceeds to melt the silver over a Bunsen burner. He then picks up the crucible and turns to pour the silver into a cast. And all of a sudden, he trips and pours molten silver inches from his face. Oh no! Then, the carpet begins to smolder, and the chem teacher pops up and grabs an extinguisher to put out the fire that he had started. You can still see the burn marks on the chem classroom carpet to this day. To top this all off, it was later found that the silver nitrate container was not airtight, and over time, enough of the solvent had evaporated that crystals had started to form. Yeah, that's a sketchy situation. Silver's not even worth that much, so I'm not really sure why he would have saved it up. If you look up the price of silver per gram, it's actually relatively cheap. Silver gets a reputation of being a really precious metal, but it's not too expensive. Back when I did QC, I would sometimes have to fill out the "you done messed up and here's why" forms after testing, and they would helpfully calculate the dollar value of the batch that was lost to said mess up. It was always darkly amusing when the total dollar amount was worth more than my salary for the year. Oh my goodness, that's insane. I can't even imagine doing that. You shouldn't be able to make a mistake in your day-to-day job where you can screw up so much that it costs the organization more than your yearly salary. Maybe the reason that it was worth more than your salary is because you weren't being adequately compensated. I hope that that was not the case, however. At least no one's health was on the line at my old job. Unless this is the third batch you've had to reject and the production chemist is about to pop a vein, because they've been staying late all week trying to troubleshoot what the heck is going wrong. Yeah, that sounds like a really stressful environment. It doesn't sound like a super healthy environment. It makes me wonder if there's any good human resources department there, because that definitely sounds a little bit suspicious. I'm not a chemist, but as a senior mechanical engineering student, we were often asked by many other departments to fix, design, slash make things for their research and experiments, especially if facilities felt it was just above their pay grade or didn't want to deal with it. One time, a chem grad grad student ran into our workshop saying that his glove box lost power and needed to be fixed immediately or it would ruin his work. When I got there, the whole lab smelled like bleach, but I figured that this was normal for a chemistry lab. Our workshops always smell like oil and isopropanol after all. I started diagnosing the unit and quickly found out the issue to be a dead RCBO. Because the chem student said that it was urgent, I started taking apart the electronics of another empty glove box to temporarily steal a replacement RCBO from it. Before I got done though, I noticed the bleach smell had increased and I found it harder to breathe. Just a couple minutes later, the chem student told me it was too late and that I had to run. He hit the button to evacuate the building. Turns out he was working in a negative pressure box with liquid chlorine. Not dissolved, but liquefied chlorine gas at basically atmospheric pressure. That is absolutely insane. That is not a normal thing. I have never heard of anybody working with liquid chlorine in a negative pressure glove box. Yikes. The thing he was using to keep it condensed as a liquid was powered from the glove box, and so as it failed, the chlorine started rapidly evaporating and filling the box. With the extraction fan also down, it slowly leaked out and filled the room. I would have appreciated it if he had told me that beforehand. Yeah, no kidding. I think, in the end, they just turned up the HVAC and waited for the chlorine to disperse out, and no one was seriously injured. I had a cough for a couple days after, though. Yeah, you literally got chlorine gas attacked by a grad student. If you ever have something break down like that, it would be better to get everybody out of the lab and then figure out what to do so that nobody could potentially get harmed by literal chlorine gas. Yikes. I remember pre-high school, one of my friends was obsessed with bromine. It was his favorite element and he wanted to make it. A couple of years later, probably age 15 or 16, he decided to make it by himself and accidentally managed to inhale enough bromine fumes that he was still coughing the next day at school. Kids should not be making bromine. I have smelled small amounts of bromine before and it is way more offensive than iodine. It is sketchy that kids are making bromine and parents need to be paying a little bit better attention in my opinion. So this is the big story for today's episode. I worked in a small environmental lab for my first couple years out of college. After I'd been at the company for about 2 years, my company was bought out by the only other environmental lab in the region. I really started looking for a new job at this point. The new ownership and longer commute didn't really excite me. The owner for the new lab really gave off a weird vibe. The first time I met him, in a company-wide meeting to discuss the buyout, he just stared at me with a stink eye throughout the whole meeting, in between him rambling for 45 minutes about how he's a self-made man and does good business. The second time I met him, he told me that we don't need plastic ventilation boxes around the ICP and ICP-MS. ICP stands for inductively coupled plasma, and ICP-MS is where they do inductively coupled plasma, followed by mass spectrometry. So it's a good way to look at the different metals you have as well as metal isotopes. We don't need plastic ventilation boxes around the ICP-MS and ICP-MS autosampler trays because hydrochloric acid and nitric acid are good to breathe in on a 40-hour a week basis. I'm a little off track, but the backstory is important. The guy was a monster and not very smart. After the buyout was complete, I found out firsthand how terrible of a company it was. The safety issues and OSHA violations were horrifying. There was actually a vent that just spewed HCl permanganate mercury standard into the atmosphere near the entrance of the building. What the heck? Again, lost focus to the point of the story, but the meat and potatoes of it is this. 4 years ago, the building burned down, and there was a lot of mystery surrounding the fire and why or how it happened. It wasn't until a friend that I worked with at the previous company reached out to me and asked how the transition was. I was very honest, and they found me a new job, academic and more money. Couldn't be happier. In a research lab within a month. I ended up working with their fiancé, and they told me the entire story surrounding the mystery of the fire. 4 years before this, the owner took on a contract with some Europeans to make diabetic test strips. The process apparently involved elemental bromine, so this guy, on a Saturday morning, decided to boil elemental bromine in a 3-liter flask outside of the hood. He was tired of waiting for it, so he decided he should go eat Arby's. Him being the only person in the building, due to it being a weekend, made this a solid decision. However, there was an employee that worked on a short shift to check on the instruments every Saturday. They showed up to a fire overtaking the wet chemistry bench. They sprayed it with a fire extinguisher and nothing changed. So in the end, this employee evacuated and called the fire department. Long story short, the lab burned down. Insurance money was profitable, and the employee who tried to put out the fire was blamed for it and fired shortly after. No! No! I now work with that employee's fiancé. This story has been confirmed with many previous employees of the company. There are a lot more details to the stupidity of it, but I think I've said enough. Moral of the story is, don't boil bromine on the bench, and then go to Arby's. Yeah, I think that's a good lesson, and only intervene if you know it's safe to do so. Sometimes intervening can make things worse, and it's better to leave intervention to the professionals who are trained to do so. I have worked with hydrozoic acid in the Mitsunobu reaction. Hydrozoic acid is the acid form of azide, the very toxic anion that is also explosive. It is not that bad in dilute solutions, I disagree. I made it by putting sodium azide in DMF, followed by the slow addition of concentrated hydrochloric acid under stirring. Then I centrifuged the mixture to precipitate sodium sulfate, leaving hydrazoic acid and DMF as a clear solution on top of it. That's so sketchy. I think that's very sketchy. If you wouldn't want Grimace doing this, that makes it sketchy. Comment down below if you would want Grimace to do this. However, I poured it down the drain as I no longer needed it. This is also concerning. The vapors made it slightly hard to breathe for a few minutes. Thankfully, nothing serious. Everything about this sounds super sketchy, and I feel like you could have done this with a weaker non-nucleophilic acid so that you don't have to make hydrazoic acid. That is super scary. Also, let's just highlight another issue here. If you're a chemist, you'll see the issue here. You cannot add concentrated sulfuric acid to DMF. That causes the decomposition of DMF, and that can also be explosive. So this is not a great story. There's a lot of issues here. Don't do this, kids. My uncle was an industrial chemist, and one time when I was around 5, he decided to demonstrate starting fire with water using potassium permanganate and glycerin. He kind of overdid it though, with a huge pile of it in an aluminum pan which caught fire upon the addition of water, and that's how I learned that metals can burn. Yeah, if you get aluminum hot enough, it will absolutely burn, just like magnesium. Today's Yikes Awardee goes to Froto. I doubt they do it today, but when I attended elementary school, every classroom had a giant bucket of paste, and I recall in third grade seeing a kid reach in and grab a big glob of it and just start munching away. This is one of those multiple decades old memories that sticks with you. Yeah, that's terrible. I have a similar story. I once went to summer camp, and a friend of mine let us all know that he liked eating toothpaste, and he would just squeeze a whole tube of toothpaste into his mouth and just gobble it down. And after the other people in the cabin saw him doing this, they offered him their toothpastes to taste, and then he rated the tastes of all the different toothpastes. You know, I bet this guy could even do a toothpaste tier list. Polyvinyl pyrrolidine story. I worked for a plant that did custom work and development work. One customer made a PNVP solution in ethanol. This mixture was the base of a hairspray product that was about half of the total market at the time. California enacted some laws that limited the allowable volatile organic compound emissions for the products that included hairspray, so the company had to find a way to create PNVP in a water solution. To do this, the company rented out some equipment, utilities, and people to the customer, and we executed their development plan. Nothing extreme happened, but we had more bad batches than good batches as we determined the right conditions for large-scale polymerization in a new solvent. The bad batches included many bad batches of eggs and other forms of PNVP that had hard shells on the outside and gooey low molecular weight polymer on the inside. One time we pushed the limit and made a giant egg 4 foot by 3 foot that contained most of the NVP feed material. It looked like it should contain an alien. The fun was over when we attempted to break it open. It was super strong. Eventually we said screw this and dissolved it in ethanol. This is a really interesting story. I don't know if there's too much to learn from it, but I thought it was kind of entertaining, so I felt the need to include it. I don't think the body generates and uses nitrogen dioxide, but instead, nitrogen monoxide. The biological use of nitrogen monoxide is extensive in the human body. I haven't worked with nitric oxide. If you have a hot girlfriend, then yes, you have. Have a great day.